Good evening and a very warm welcome to our special Christmas Eve communion service here at St. Peter's. I'm delighted that you are able to join us for this service online. Tonight we're going to have the wonderful Ruth Parry Jennings preaching to us and bringing us a message of hope this Christmas. Later on in our service, we are going to be celebrating Holy Communion. And even though we can't be together in the church building, I would like to invite you, if you haven't already, to have perhaps bread and wine with you so that we can join in when we celebrate Holy Communion later in our service. Also, at times during our service, there will be liturgy, which will appear on your screen. Please do feel free to join in with the words in bold text. You might want to say those words out loud, or if you're a little bit embarrassed to do that, please do say those words in the quietness of your own heart, as together this evening we give thanks and we celebrate God sending his Son Jesus Christ into the world. Let's worship the Lord together with our first carol.
Come, all ye faith, joyful and triumphant. Oh come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. Oh come, let us adore. Come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord.
Sing, cries of angels, sing in exaltation. Sing, O ye citizens of heaven above. Glory to God, glory in the highest.
Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore.
People who walked in darkness have seen a great light. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. His name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Christ, the light of the world, has come to dispel the darkness of our hearts. Let us turn to the light and confess our sins. God our Father, you sent your Son full of grace and truth. Forgive our failure to receive him. Lord, have mercy. Jesus, our Saviour, you were born in poverty and laid in a manger. Forgive our greed and rejection of your ways. Christ, have mercy. Spirit of love, your servant Mary responded joyfully to your call. Forgive the hardness of our hearts. Lord, have mercy. May the God of all healing and forgiveness draw you to himself and cleanse you from all your sins, that you may behold the glory of his Son, the Word made flesh, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's pray together this evening's collect. Eternal God, who made this most holy night to shine with the brightness of your one true light, bring us who have known the revelation of that light on earth to see the radiance of your heavenly glory. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Kathy is now going to bring us our Old Testament reading.
Today's Old Testament reading is from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 1 to 5. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her hard service has been completed, that her sin has been paid for, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up, every mountain and hill made low. The rough ground shall become level, the rugged places a plain, and the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all people will see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. This is the word of the Lord.
Born a child and yet a king. hearts of kings. Even as a baby, you were changing everything. You called me to your kingdom before your lips could speak. Even as a baby, you were reaching out for me. And now we are awaiting the day of your return. Heaven comes to earth, until the sky is open, until the trumpet sounds, the bride is getting ready, the church is singing out. Come, thou long expected Jesus, one to set thy people free.
Well, I know we are watching our service this evening from our homes, but I would like to invite us, if you would like to and you're able to stand for our gospel reading. So if you want to, please stand as Kathy reads our gospel reading.
The reading is taken from John chapter 1, verses 1 to 14. In the beginning, the Word already existed. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He existed in the beginning with God. God created everything through him, and nothing was created except through him. The Word gave life to everything that was created, and his life brought life to everyone. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness can never extinguish it. God sent a man, John the Baptist, to tell about the light so that everyone might believe because of his testimony. John himself was not the light. He was simply a witness to tell about the light. The one who is the true light, who gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He came into the very world he created, but the world didn't recognize him. He came to his own people, and even they rejected him. But to all who believed him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. They are reborn, not with a physical birth resulting from human passion or plan, but a birth that comes from God. So the Word became human and made his home among us. He was full of unfailing love and faithfulness, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the Father's one and only Son. This is the word of the Lord.
Good evening. Let's pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord. Amen. Isn't it a wonderful privilege to be here at this very special communion service on the brink of Christmas? To take time after all the busyness, the stress and the strain of the last days, weeks, months, time to pause, be still, and reflect on just what has been accomplished in the birth of Jesus Christ, and what will be accomplished through him. When John wrote his gospel, his account of the life of Jesus, he was writing towards the end of his life, setting down the truth about the man he'd seen with his own eyes and touched with his own hands, the one he called the Word of Life. He was writing for those exploring faith in Christ, for beginners in the faith, and also for more mature Christians, for the Jewish and the Greek believers in the church. What he writes is both simple and profound. It took John just 225 God-inspired words to explain who Jesus is and what he's accomplished and what that means for each one of us. So few words to explain the grace and truth of God working on a vast eternal scale. And yet, in the opening verses we have just heard read, John doesn't mention Jesus by name at all. He calls him the Word. Why would he do this? John begins, "In the beginning was the Word." The Word already existed. The Word was with God. The Word was God. This is John setting the scene on a vast eternal scale. Already we're being drawn into something mysterious, something almost beyond our understanding. The Word is an unfamiliar term to us, but in Greek thinking it meant not just what was spoken, but what was unspoken. The Word still in the mind, not yet in being. And when the Jews listened, they would have recognized "in the beginning" as the very first words of the account of creation and linked them to their understanding that the Word meant God, the creator of heaven and earth, the one God who had drawn them, called them into a covenant relationship. In uniting these two understandings, John is telling us that before anything was created, before darkness, light, water, and any form of life appeared, before the heavens and the earth as we know them existed, Jesus, the Word of God, existed with God and was God. He is the one who calls life into being, the one who gives life its light. Everything was created through him. And everything he made was declared good. That includes us. We were made in the image of God. We were made to be beautiful. What does that mean to you? To me, it means we were made whole, healthy, and beloved in God's eyes. We were made for intimate relationship with him, free to enjoy him and worship him, free to trust him and have fullness of life in him, free to choose him, and free to choose to trust him to direct our lives. Obedience to his commands was never meant to flow from fear of punishment, but from our understanding that his will and his commands always flow from his grace. They are always loving, good, life-giving, trustworthy, and true. As human beings, we are capable of making beautiful choices, of reflecting the God who made us. We can be loving, kind, compassionate, generous, caring, faithful, self-giving. But who would say all of their choices were good? Sometimes we just don't do the good things we want to do. Sometimes we make very unhealthy, light and life-denying, God-denying choices. Our reasons vary. We might choose thoughtlessly, without due consideration, not understanding the consequences of our choices. We might choose from negligence. Or perhaps we choose through weakness, because we know the right thing to do, but we don't have the courage or the strength to say no. And sometimes, when God tells us quite clearly through his Spirit that an action will cause us harm, have long-term results we can't possibly imagine, we just don't want to hear it. And we deliberately close our hearts and minds to him. And the relationship suffers. We may feel shame and guilt, so we run away and hide. Or perhaps we justify our actions and cling to our pride, refusing to admit our wrongs. Either way, we cannot find our way back to the beauty we once had. We cannot undo the harm that has been done. Something in us is broken. We can't put it right, but God can. How? Because God so loved the world, before we acknowledged our wrongs, before we asked for forgiveness, he sent the Word, his one and only Son. The one through whom all things were made, the one who came voluntarily to join us in our broken humanity, to take every temptation the darkness could throw at him, that we could throw at him, every cruelty, every injustice, every denial, every betrayal, and he still chose love, mercy, compassion, forgiveness. And at the end of his life, from the cross, the place of intolerable darkness and suffering, the Word, Jesus, chose to say, "Father, forgive them. They do not know what they are doing." He chose to die for our sake so that we might have eternal life with him. And he proved beyond doubt in his resurrection, his triumph over death, that in him light is greater than darkness. Love is greater than hate. Mercy triumphs over justice. Well, what does that mean for us? It means everything for us. In him, we are forgiven, and we are invited to share in his life and in his kingdom here on earth. And when our lives on earth have ended, we are invited to enjoy a fullness of life and joy with God beyond our imagining, and forever. How can we trust this? Because John is our eyewitness. He tells us that he beheld the glory of the resurrected Christ. He saw him with his own eyes. He touched him with his own hands and can categorically state as fact, it is true. Jesus is alive. We are beautiful. We are broken. We are forgiven. And we are invited. The invitation couldn't be clearer. To all who believe him and accept him, Jesus gives the right to become children of God, born of God. Personal invitations require a personal response. It's Christmas Eve at the stable. The baby is born. The Word has become flesh, a living, breathing baby. How will we respond? We can approach and kneel and say, "Yes, please, I would love to receive what you are offering me. light and life, healing, joy, peace. Or we can look away and say, I'm not sure about this. I need to be certain that this is real, and turn away without giving ourselves the opportunity to explore what's on offer. If we already know Jesus, we might say, I'm happy with where you've brought me so far, Jesus. I'm not sure I want more. And we'll turn away from the good things God is longing to give us. Or we can say, no, thank you. Not interested. Not for me. Turn on our heel and walk smartly away. We are free to do that. In the relationship God is offering, we are free to do that, as we are in any relationship. We always have in God the freedom to choose. In the beginning, the Word gave us the freedom to choose. We are invited, not compelled, not coerced. It's an invitation to relationship, not to slavery. To beauty restored, brokenness healed, and to life beyond anything we could ask or imagine. The invitation has been issued. How will we respond tonight? May God give us the grace to say yes. Amen.
As we respond to Ruth's sermon, let's affirm our faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Rejoice, Emmanuel. shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, desire of nations fine, O peoples in one heart. Envy, strife, and quarrels cease. Fill the whole world with heaven's peace. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. Rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel.
As we prepare to receive God's holy gifts this evening, let's take a moment of reflection and quiet to open ourselves up to God and to all that he might have for us tonight, as we are fed by his body and his blood. Let's pray together. The Lord is here, his spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts, we lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. All glory and honour be yours always and everywhere. Mighty Creator, ever living God, we give you thanks and praise for your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, who for love of our fallen race humbled himself, was born of the Virgin Mary by the power of your Spirit and lived as one of us. In this mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused his light to shine in our hearts, to give knowledge of your glory in the face of Jesus Christ. In him we see our God made visible, and so are caught up in the love of the God we cannot see. Therefore, with all the angels of heaven, we lift our voices to proclaim the glory of your name and sing our joyful hymn of praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Accept our praises, Heavenly Father, through your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, and as we follow his example and obey his command, grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and his blood, who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." To you be glory and praise forever. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." To you be glory and praise forever. Therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember his offering of himself, made once for all upon the cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. We look for the coming of your kingdom. And with this bread and this cup, we make the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Lord. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Accept through him, our great high priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts, in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your spirit, inspire us with your love, and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. To you be glory and praise forever. Through him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honour and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Come to this table, not because you must, but because you may. Come, not because you have all faith, but because you have some faith and would like to grow in it. Come, because you love the Lord a little and would like to love him more. Come, because he loves you and wants to give you everything. Come, because all is ready and we are his body.
Sin and error high.
Well, thank you so much for joining us for this Christmas Eve communion service. Perhaps you've watched this service and you would like to find out more about the Christian faith and the good news of Jesus Christ. If you would, I would really like to encourage you to join us for our upcoming Alpha course beginning in the new year, the details of which will be on the screen now. And if you would like to join us for the upcoming Alpha course, it's a great way for you to perhaps begin to ask questions that you have about the Christian faith. We would love to welcome you to Alpha. Let me close our service with a blessing over each one of us. May the Father, who has loved the eternal Son from before the foundation of the world, shed that love upon you, his children. May Christ, who by his incarnation gathered into one things earthly and heavenly, fill you with joy and peace. May the Holy Spirit, by whose overshadowing Mary became the God-bearer, give you grace to carry the good news of Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon us and our families this Christmas and forever. Amen.